What's up, YouTube? Ryan Panny here. Hope you're doing reasonably well. It is time for a review of the new Nas record, Nasir, out two Fridays ago, June 15th. On my fanboy shit with this one. I mean, I can't really help it. Like, Nas is essentially the individual solely responsible for my love of hip hop. And ever since I've loved hip hop, I have loved Nas. And over the years, I've basically molded my criteria for a great MC around Nas's characteristics. And also, in contrast to the people who believe that, like, everything you need to know about Nas begins and ends with his classic album Illmatic, I'm part of that other camp that actually thinks that Nas has a very strong catalog when you really look at it. I mean, in my opinion, he has four certifiable classics. There's Illmatic, there's Stillmatic, there's It Was Written, and there's Godson. And then a lot of his other albums have majority quality material on it, like I Am, like Hip Hop Is Dead, and most recently, 2012's Life Is Good, which is the album that he's essentially following up with this one. Life Is Good, man, I can't even begin to describe how much I love that album. And it's not perfect by any means, but when you look at it, it did have an impact on hip hop. And that impact was best summed up by this post I found a while back on Rap Genius, which I'll link it down in the description of this video if you want to read the whole thing. But this author was writing about how Life Is Good, it was one of a few albums that helped contribute to this new subgenre of hip hop that this author deemed adult contemporary hip hop. Because when you listen through Life Is Good, you know, Nas is tackling familiar subjects, his come up and street life and all that, but these are topics that are now being written about from the perspective of a mature 40-year-old man who has been there and done that and can only really talk about this shit in retrospect or with a certain air of nostalgia in his voice. It's more the perspective of an OG now and of an elder statesman of the genre. And furthermore, when you dig through more of the content of that record, it's the perspective of someone who now has mature adult shit going on, like a marriage slash divorce, and a teenage daughter of his own who he famously rapped about in the track Daughters, which is one of the best hip-hop songs ever written, if you ask me, and it is probably like indirect inspiration behind Kanye's new song Violent Crimes off his new album Ye. And basically the author's whole point in that post was that hip-hop isn't old enough to have a generation yet where it's just all these old people talking about old people's shit, and we're finally there. We got Eminem, we got Jay-Z, we got Nas, all these people, Scarface, they're all still around, still making albums. So if they're being true to themselves and not to becoming caricatures of their past discography, they're gonna start talking about what it's like to be 45. And so that opens up a whole new lane in hip hop. But I think one of the best examples of that little subgenre is actually the new Jay-Z Beyonce joint album, where they're rapping about their marriage and their kids and their bills and whatever other shit. But that whole elder statesman, adult contemporary hip hop thing by no means has to be Nas's approach on this new one, Nasir. I mean, I think one of the beautiful things about this record is that we're all pretty much going into it with a completely clean slate and zero expectations. The guy's been gone for 6 years. I mean, all I knew about, and I think all most people knew about it, was 7 tracks, Kanye West beats, Nas rhymes, and that's it. And the record actually came out on my birthday too, so I was able to just sit there and unwrap my present and give it a listen and see what I thought in a more organic way than normally. So the opening cut on here, Not For Radio, it actually kickstarts this album with a quick callback to Nas and Puffy's classic 1999 single Hate Me Now, with Nas defiantly announcing the beginning of Escobar season in the opening seconds of this track, which of course is appropriate because Puffy is featured on this track and he's talking his shit the same way he did in 1999 with Hate Me Now. And the instrumental on this track, which Kanye actually co-produced with Mike Dean, Benny Blanco, and Cashmere Cat, it kicks off this album in truly grand, larger-than-life fashion with these classical choir vocals and these strings coming together over trap drums. This chorus has these real militant toms and another fantastic guest appearance from 070 Shake, the new Kanye protege that everyone's talking about. God, I can't wait to hear a full-length album from her. All of her appearances have been phenomenal, not excluding this one. But my initial excitement about this track quickly fades as I realize that all the best things about it are not Nas. An epic instrumental and a couple of spirited guest contributions are ultimately what power this song. And you realize that as you start to pay more attention to what Nas is saying in these lyrics, which to me are uncharacteristically flat. His second verse on here does bring some content. Like, he talks about the whole fallacy that Abe Lincoln really wanted to completely abolish slavery, which he's right about. He talks about America getting rich off the Colombian drug trade, okay. But then the rest of the verse is just either like half-hearted conspiracy theories. Like, he's talking about how like The SWAT was created just to combat the Black Panthers, which I'm pretty sure a lot of historians would disagree with that. Or he's just like making simple statements of fact, like Ronald Reagan had Alzheimer's. No shit, that's nothing new. And the way he's rapping, it definitely feels like I'm supposed to find this verse super deep and super compelling, but I just don't. And that's the thing with me and this album, like being the enormous Nas fan that I am, I have like half the guy's catalog memorized, it's very, very easy for me to spot half-baked, toned-down lyricism from the guy. And unfortunately, that's what pretty much defines this album for me. The guy's just rapping like he doesn't care. Like on the second track, Cop Shot the Kid, which features a classic Licorice sample from Children's Story and opens up that heated discussion of police brutality, it's Kanye who completely outshines Nas with actually the best verse on the whole album. He's got a couple of lines in there that I love, like people making money when a mom cries, or why should we call 911 when 911 is doing the drive-by? And Nas, by comparison, just has all these clunky, underwhelming things to say about the disadvantages of the brown and y'all are killing my vibe or blowing my high. He just sounds surprisingly uninspired for a weighty topic like this, and a topic that has seen so much discussion in Nas's 6-year absence too. And then you take a look at the fourth track on here, the luxurious Bonjour, which features these like little mini 8-bar verses that like even if Nas had something profound to say, he wouldn't even have the time to say it. But again, the guy shows an uncharacteristically little concern for lyricism. He's rhyming words like stressing and flexing and blessing. It's, as a Nas fan, it's just really tough to hear. Even with the track Everything, which is the track where Nas does give us the most content. He offers his perspective on vaccinations. He talks about the Starbucks incident. He even gets in a little jab at Trump with the line about Nestle. Even on this song, he just seems uninterested in trying to rhyme words in creative ways. He seems uninterested in the craft of emceeing, which I guess that's cool if that's just like not a priority for him anymore when he makes music, but you gotta understand, for fans like me, this is why we come to Nas. It's certainly not for the beat selection and the hooks most of the time, so it's gotta be for something. It's for bars. But on this album, he doesn't only sound aimless from a technical rapping standpoint, he also sounds aimless thematically. Like, take the super plain closing track, Simple Things, for instance, which is a song that basically comes across more like an interlude than a song, to be honest. But, you know, this song's got a hook about the simple things in life, right? But then the whole first verse is Nas bragging. And then the second verse, Nas says that his humility is infectious.
Huh?
Then on a song like White Label, content-wise, he's basically just free associating. I mean, he does get in a little plug for his daughter's brand of lipstick, Lipmatic. I guess you could consider that a victory business-wise. I don't know. Ugh, this album just has a really sore absence of those purely conceptual Nas tracks. You know, think I Gave You Power, or Rewind, or Second Childhood, or Daughters. And you know, it actually has an absence of any sort of narrative, to be honest. And you know what makes this so much worse? Is when you think about how the guy hasn't put out an album in 6 years. Like, you'd think that after 6 years of being gone, he'd have a lot to say, right? But Mr. West comes running through and fucking saves him on these beats. Which I should mention, he did produce with a bunch of collaborators, like Benny Blanco and Cashmere Cat I mentioned. Plain Pat also contributed here, but either way you slice it, the beats on this album are fire. I think the White Label beat has a really unique sound to it between that vocal sample and those blaring jazzy horns coming in. I mean, I'd imagine it'd actually be pretty difficult to rap over, but a cool backdrop nonetheless. Adam and Eve is a super dope beat, one of my favorites. I love how it marries the boom bap feel with that addicting piano line and a little bit of warm acoustic guitar in the background for texture. And this song is probably the best example of Nas being carried by a beat, because he's rapping about, like, he's bragging, excuse me, about spending $20,000 on some girl he just met. Like, to a frugal motherfucker like me, that sounds like a fucking nightmare. That does not sound like a boast at all. And Bonjour has an incredibly lavish and sexy sound to it, and is probably my favorite song on the album, but again, for reasons that are not Nas. The reasons on this one are the beat, and I like Tony Williams' singing a lot on here too. This is the kind of beat I feel like Rick Ross would have been great over this beat, just based on the way his last album, Rather You Than Me, sounded. But yeah, that's ultimately what bumps me out here, is that Nas is often not the best part of his own album. The album is decent and certainly listenable, but Kanye gets the bulk of the credit here. The production carries Nas, it just does. He's not his sharpest or most technical or most insightful or most anything, really. He's just kind of there, and he doesn't sound like he wants to be. I still love his flow here and there, and he gets in some nice bars and everything, and in White Label, but most of the appeal of this record, if there is one, is all in what's behind Nas, which, for an MC of his caliber, it's not good. I'm left feeling very uninspired by this record, just disappointed in one of my heroes letting me down. And it's the kind of troubling disappointment where at this stage in Nas's long career, I'm genuinely wondering if I'm ever gonna enjoy another project by Nas ever again. Because if he's just bored and tired of rapping and out of things to say, then that's that. But you know what? If that is the case, hell of a run, right? I feel the same way about Eminem and his last album. You can't take anything away. If this is truly the end of anything good or anything that is gonna stand the test of time, look at the fucking catalog. The guy is a legend either way. Nasir gets a 5 out of 10 from me. As always, thanks so much for watching, guys. If you enjoyed this video and are not yet subscribed, please consider doing so by clicking right over here or just checking out any of the other content that I publish on this channel on a weekly basis. I really appreciate you supporting, watching, liking, commenting, arguing, sharing. Any and all of the above means the world to me. And thanks for watching, and I will see you soon.